I came out this morning, I was bringing everything out, and the birds were all up against the chicken coop. And I thought, that's kind of odd. They're normally not that quiet. And I went walking around there, and there's this old dead tree on the corner of my property, a big honking hawk. Just, yeah, honking. He took off. And I thought, oh crap, they found my chickens. Because once they find him, they'll keep coming back too. And he took off and he started soaring. And Rascal was over here drinking out of the water puddle. And I said, where's Birdie? And when I say, where's Birdie, Rascal's ears perk up and he went nuts. His little tiny thumbs of legs weren't even visible. I mean, he just went flying like a centipede on crack. Went flying across the yard barking at this thing, and it disrupted the hawk, and the hawk took off way over the hills and decided to hunt elsewhere. So he's on the job. He's definitely on the job. Anyway, today on this cold morning, we got our beds done, and that was actually a lot easier than I thought. I thought it was going to be a pain in the butt. Turns out it's not. The brackets worked extremely well. The beds are various sizes, and that's what I'm going to show you in a minute. But first, I'm going to start making the soil. I'm going to go over to my compost pile, and the compost is the stuff that I made out of grass. Remember, I was making grass compost all season? Well, I have what's left of it. I've been using it for compost tea, and I have what's left of it over here, and it's this big matted pile of dark matter, and it's actually quite nice. And I don't use a whole lot per wheelbarrow full. Ew, this is gooey looking stuff. I just need a shovel full of this stuff. Little goes a long way when you have really rich condensed compost. Bring it over here. And I was doing this yesterday, and I thought, you know what, I should actually film the filling of the beds, because people are going to want to see that. So here we go. That is some thick stuff, and it's really gooey and sticky, because I was making grass compost this year, and it turned out perfect. It was the most wonderful compost. But any kind of compost, almost any kind of compost, if you just let it set there in a pile and it rains on it, it gets condensed, it rains on it, gets condensed. This is after it's done cooking. If you let it just sit there, eventually it becomes this thick, hard mass of stuff, and sometimes it'll go anaerobic on you, but that's okay. Some people have this misconception that anaerobic is bad. It really isn't. Okay, anyway, this sticky mess goes just like that. All right, one shovelful is all I need, because I'm only using it for the nutrients in the compost because of the second step. These are the blocks of cocoa peat, or coir as they call it. I buy these, oh, I'm sorry, I was a little close there. I buy this stuff in 11 pound blocks, and these are actually separated into flakes, so it makes it easier to break apart. So I'm just breaking these apart into pieces, and some of them don't flake apart, but it really doesn't matter. I can just toss it in there. Now, I've shown you how I use cocoa peat indoors for gardening. Now, what cocoa peat is, for those who haven't seen my 1 million episodes talking about it, all it is it's the hairs and shavings off the outside of a coconut. Companies harvest billions and billions of coconuts, and they shave off the hairs and stuff. They don't know what to do with them, so what they do is they pile them in these huge piles. They let them naturally rinse off from rainwater, or they flood them and rinse off the salts to get them off of there. Reputable companies do. And then they take this stuff and they shred it up, and then they compress it in these compactors. And it's called cocoa peat. Not because it's actual peat moss. But anyway, yeah, it's all compressed and dried. You throw it in a container, you add water, and it expands really huge. And the nice thing about coir is, let me show you a handful of this. Once you add water to this, it rehydrates to the consistency of like used coffee grounds. And the nice thing about cocoa peat is it's non-acidic, whereas regular peat moss is acidic. And if you want acidic soil, that's fine, but I don't. So this stuff has the virtue of being light and fluffy, and it lets oxygen into the soil, air into the soil. The roots can penetrate this so fast, so easy. It holds just enough moisture to be moist, but it allows the excess to be drained. And you might be thinking, hey, that sounds like a miracle. How can that be true? Well, it actually is. It's actually a miracle product as far as I'm concerned, and it's not soil. This has no nutrients whatsoever. That's why I'm putting the compost in there. When I add water to the compost, it makes this slurry of very rich compost tea. I put in a big shovel full of that. That would normally make about 10 gallons of very rich compost tea to water my garden. So when I add the water to this, it's going to rehydrate the compost into compost tea. The compost tea is going to absorb into the coir and enrich that to be a growing medium that's light, fluffy, holds moisture, and has nutrients in it as well. Now, herein lies the tricky part. Don't ever do what I did yesterday. Yesterday, I took the hose because I figured I'm outside. I'll just take the water hose and pour in water. And I poured in water and this big block just floated around like a raft out on the ocean. And I thought, oh, that's right. I totally forgot. When you're rehydrating cocoa peat, you want to use warm water. Warm water or hot water, because it soaks in a lot faster. If you put it in cold water, it takes forever. And that's what it did. I stood out here for a half an hour and just watched this big old brown thing float around. So I brought out 2 5-gallon containers of warm water. Yes, I actually had to go into the house, put these buckets in my bathtub, and fill them full of warm water. Now, as far as how much water to use, I have no idea. It just depends on what kind of mood the cocoa peat is in. So I toss that in there. Yeah, the roosters are starting to crow. Now, this is by no means an instant process, and I have all day. I'm doing this as kind of like a therapy type of thing. I'm not in a rush to get my beds done, so you're not going to see anybody rushing through a program to show you how to fill your beds, because that's just not how I do things. If you want an instant way to do it, I don't know, I'm sure there's somebody out there that's gonna do that. So I'm gonna just hold this underneath, and you see how dark the water is? Yep, that's the compost. I'm gonna just mix it up, make sure the compost gets all mixed up in there. And I think within about maybe 4 or 5 minutes, because that's nice and warm, I may have to add more water. In 4 or 5 minutes, this is gonna start. You need to work on that. You sound like crap. That's the big fat white turkey. Yep. I'm sorry. Big fat white chicken. Yeah. Work on that. I have roosters. Yes, I do. I love that sound. And they will do that all day long. People that think, hey, roosters only crow in the morning. You've apparently never had roosters. They do it all day long. Sometimes I had one that used to do it in his sleep. Yeah, out of the chicken coop, I'd hear in the middle of the night, and it sounds like somebody was choking him. Okay, flip this around. Starting to break apart, and the more they break apart, that's why I was breaking them apart earlier. Normally, I have a pocket knife out here, and I can split them apart. And the more surface area, the faster it's going to rehydrate. Okay, we'll come back as soon as this is hydrated, and go on to my next step. First thing I have, you already saw that, is the cocoa peat. I love this stuff for indoor growing, outdoor growing. It is fantastic stuff. Not so much economical for filling a huge garden. I mean, you'd probably want to truck in some soil if you're going to do a huge garden. I don't really have a huge garden, so I can make my own soil, and that's what I want to do, because unlike trucked in soil, they can say it's anything they want, but I don't know where that stuff came from, and so I don't really trust anything that I didn't have a hand in making or know a lot about. So I'm not going to trust trucked in soil. You never know where that stuff comes from. So I got the coir. That's one of the ingredients. I also went online throughout the year, because I had this planned for quite a while. I got 25 40-pound bags of what's called mushroom compost. The brand name is unimportant, but what mushroom compost is, it's when the companies are growing mushrooms, you know, where you get mushrooms at the store, they generally, not all of them, but they generally take cow manure, and they get it in bulk, you know, in semi-loads, and it's all decomposed and broken down. It's composted. Then they use this in their underground chambers to grow mushrooms. And then when the mushrooms are grown, they've used up a lot of the nutrients. Not all of them, but enough to where they don't think it's economical to use it for another crop of mushrooms. So they take it all out and they sell it. And that's what you get. This was only like $3 for a 40-pound bag. That's dirt cheap. Pun. And so I bought a whole bunch of these. So I'm going to mix the coir with the compost with water to get it filled with nutrients. And I'm also going to use the mushroom compost as one of many ingredients. So I got that. slice it right up the stomach and let it just fall right out. Okay, that was a gross little comparison, but you know what I mean. Open the bag, toss it out, and what I'm doing is I'm laying on some coir, and then I take this mushroom compost. It's really good. It's really dark. It looks rich. It's wonderful stuff. And then I just lay that on top of it as well. Spread it out. Next ingredient that I have. All throughout the year, I've been buying stuff on sale because I knew I was going to do raised beds. So I keep an eye on online and my friends on Facebook and YouTube. They let me know whenever things are on sale and whenever there's a good deal going on. And I do pay attention to that. And I have bone meal, because bone meal is a great source of calcium for the soil. And since I'm making my own soil, I don't have that luxury of having natural soil. This soil that's out here in the ground, this stuff was made naturally over millions of years, generally, and it has all kinds of stuff. People say, what do you ever use rock dust? And I say no, because the ground actually has rocks and minerals of all different sizes. It has them from, you know, big size to all the way to microscopic size. So it has rock dust in there. So I don't buy into the add rock dust to your garden. But if you're doing raised beds and you're making your own soil, there is no natural soil already in there. So if you want minerals in there, you're going to have to add them yourself. As far as the calcium needs of my garden, I'm sure my compost is really good at that. But I also have bone meal. So I'll be sprinkling this just lightly. How much? I don't know. It's kind of like cooking, you know? I don't actually think about the amounts. I just toss it in there and I get this feeling for what is right. And then I went to, there's this company called Kelp for Less. I really like this company. I tried them out once and they have all kinds of good stuff. Not the cheapest in the world. Oh, Lordy, here comes the rest of the army. Anyway, they did have azomite powder. Azomite powder is the rock dust that John Kohler is always going on and on and on about. It's wonderful stuff. I don't go into adding it into my regular garden, but as far as raised beds, absolutely. Azomite powder, for those of you who don't know, is literally, it's like they take rocks, certain kinds of rocks that are a certain kind of mineral, and they run it through a grinder and they make it to the consistency of flour. This is the consistency of flour. So you can actually, and the smaller the particles, the more surface area. The more surface area, the more it's going to be absorbed into the soil and by your plants. I'm just going to sprinkle this in like powder as well. So I got a box of this I've been saving. I don't use it on my indoor gardening because I have an organic fertilizer that I use inside. And then I got all kinds of stuff in this little magic box. Yes, I do. And there's this stuff called humic acid. Humic acid is great. It's stuff that's, it basically helps your plants absorb nutrients better. And it's really creepy, black, charcoal-y looking stuff. It looks like black flour. And I have a bunch of that too. I've been buying it on sale, so I just sprinkle that in as well. And I'm just doing a sampling here. I actually do this a little bit different when I'm doing a whole raised bed. I just take a handfuls and start tossing in there. I throw that in there. And then one last thing. This is kind of like making a cake. You can make it any way you want. And then this stuff is called cottonseed meal. Cottonseed meal is exactly what it sounds like. It's cotton seeds, the hulls from cotton seeds when they grow cotton. And it's good for nitrogen. It is a very good nitrogen source. And this is crumbled to the size of cornmeal type flour. You need to go away. This is not your food. I bring stuff out of a bag and they're looking at me like, Daddy, no? And so I'm gonna throw this in there as well. And I got a whole bunch of this, more than enough for these beds. I tried using it in my indoor soil mix and it just killed my plants, deader than a doornail, because it was too strong. But out here where I'm starting out with homemade soil, I think it's going to be fantastic. So I got all of those things. I got the coir. I got the, well, you saw what I have. And I just take that stuff and I generally just rake it all together, mix it up. And that is going to be my beginning soil. Nothing else is going to be mixed into this. And I'm going to let this set all winter. And then in the spring, I'm going to plant in it. But every year, I'm going to be adding compost that I make from The manure and the grass that's in the chicken coop, the mowed lawn, you know, when I make the grass compost, the compost tea, I'm going to be adding that year after year. So as good as the soil is, this is not the perfect soil. It is going to be the perfect soil. It's got the perfect start to it, but it's a good, rich, good quality soil that's going to be a nice start for my raised beds. And there's one last thing that I didn't show you yet. Let me move you over here, and I want to show you what my little secret is to making the perfect raised beds and the perfect soil. I know you're going to get a kick out of this. You weren't expecting this. Let me show you what it is. Yes, this is exactly what it looks like. This is 100% grass and leaves from my lawn. I mowed it, dumped it in here. I'm packing it down, and I'm going to water it and make sure it's nice and moist. And this is going to, and what happens is when you mow your lawn and you make a big pile of it, it eventually breaks down into a smaller pile very fast because grass is about 80% water. But the nice thing about grass, and this is something that I've actually focused on with my compost and also with my gardening, because it's such a plentiful thing that most of us can get because most of us have a yard. You know, a lot of us have a problem with buying compost, making compost, and one of the things that we all have in common, a lot of us, is that we have grass and we don't know what to do with it. Our neighbors have grass. They don't know what to do with it. Well, here's what I'm doing with it. My idea is this. Grass is about 4% nitrogen. I think it has 4% nitrogen, 1% potassium, and 2% phosphorus. That's actually a good, mild fertilizer, and it's free. That's what grass has in it, and that's what it has to offer your plants. So what I'm doing, if you take a pile of grass and you just set it over on the side of your yard, it will slowly decompose in an anaerobic, which means no oxygen because it's not being turned. It'll turn into this mass of sludge. Those of you that have tried composting grass and you forget to turn it or you're lazy, like me, you get this mass of sludge. But the thing is that is still good quality fertilizer. Anaerobic, all that is a way of composting without the use of oxygen, but it still breaks down into a good, rich compost. So what I'm doing is I'm putting in grass in here halfway up on all my beds, then I'm putting the soil on top. What's going to happen is the grass is going to decompose and slowly go down, which will take the layer of soil down, and then I add more soil and compost as time goes on. And that decomposing layer of grass, which is rich in nitrogen and potassium and phosphorus, that's going to be the lower level of the raised beds. That is going to feed the soil underneath the raised beds, attract the worms, and give those deep growing roots something to tap into. Once the plant gets going and it goes past the soil that I have, it's going to tap into that, bang. It's going to be fantastic. I wouldn't do this if I was going to grow this year because it takes time for this to break down, but I have all winter. So this is going to sit here all winter and slowly break down, and by spring, I'm thinking it's going to be just the perfect thing for my raised beds. Plus, it takes up some space and allows me to fill up my garden, and it's free. And I'm not worried about the weeds because I have enough soil on top that I'm not going to have too often many problems with weeds. This may not be something that you want to try yourself, but this is something that I'm going to do for my garden, and I know it's going to do good. I have a feeling, and like I said in one of my episodes, let's go with my gut. And my gut tells me this was a good idea. And it also goes on us, touches slightly on a procedure. Actually, the sun's in the corner of my eye. Let's go sit over here for a minute. I want to finish this up because I got something important to say about this. But like I was saying, there is a method, and I believe, I don't know how to pronounce it, but oh, I love fresh grass. The smell is happy. I love this smell. But there's a method of gardening where you bury a log or pieces of wood, and then you cover it up with rich compost, and you grow on it. I think it's called Hügelklatscher, something like that. You know what it is. I'll put the name up here, and that about 10,000 people are going to correct me on this. But it's a method of growing where you bury a piece of wood, and it's supposed to supply all the nutrients. I really don't go for that because I don't need to bury wood in my yard, and I don't want to grow like that. That's just how I choose not to grow. I'm not saying it's a bad method. I'm just saying I choose not to do that. But this method is similar to that because what I'm doing is I'm burying grass, which in itself is not going to be a growing medium for these plants. But as it decomposes and as the soil is on top of it, it's going to slowly break down and supply the soil and the plants with nutrients. So it's slightly similar to that method of growing, and I think it's going to be pretty good for my garden. So that's what this has in it. This is not pure soil right here. No, I don't have that much dirt. It is halfway up with grass and the other half is going to be soil. So this is my method of making the soil for my garden. Oh, there's stuff all over the side. This is bone meal. It's all over the place. And of course I do have a never-ending supply of compost here with my grass, with my chickens. I'm going to do just fine with the garden. This is how I'm going to be growing next year. And also that first bed that I made, the 2-foot by 16-foot, that is the space equivalent of a 4-by-8 bed. And one person asked me, a viewer asked me, Ray, do you think you could do some kind of a series on how to grow all your own food in a small amount of space? I said, I think I can do that. I don't know if I can grow all of my food in a 4-by-8 raised bed, but I'm going to give it a shot. All my vegetable needs in a 4-by-8 bed. And that's kind of cool because I can actually plan out, you know, to how many tomatoes, how many potatoes, how many carrots, how many radishes, things like that. But that's what that 2-by-16 is going to be. That's the same space equivalent of a 4-by-8. So that bed there is reserved for my intense growing situation next year to see if I can grow all of one person's vegetable needs in that amount of space. The rest of these are just going to be for fun. So we'll see how this works out. I think I'm going to get back to making more soil for the garden. I wanted to do this episode to show you how I start my raised beds. Last time I made raised beds, I just took regular black dirt that I bought in bags and I used bagged compost to start it out, and that's how I started out my beds, but I didn't have a whole lot of soil. This time, I'm going to fill these things close to the top, but each year it's going to slowly go down as the grass breaks down and I'm going to add more stuff on here. So this, as far as I'm concerned, is the perfect soil for growing my garden. It's going to have all the things I need. It's going to be light and fluffy. I don't have to worry about making it that way as the years go on. It actually starts out that way. And year by year, it's going to get better and better and better. So there we go, folks. I got my raised beds and I'm not giving up on the regular garden. I think next year I might grow corn out there. I haven't grown corn in a long time, but I figured, what the heck? I think I'm going to grow corn next year. And I think it's going to do good out here. Come on, it's Iowa. It's the corn state. I think I can grow corn in Iowa. Okay, well, before the chickens start digging this around, I better get some more dirt out here. Thanks for joining me for this two-part series on how to make the perfect beds and the perfect soil. Hope you enjoyed it. Talk to you soon. Have a great day. Stay out of my beds.